Today, we are here to talk about understanding user churn in GoPay particularly, and how Gojek as an organization has looked at this problem. How did we formulate it, the mathematical details of it, and how did we actually implement the solution finally. So, but before we dive way deep into what exactly all of these things are, let's first talk about Gojek. Can we have a show of hands, like how many people know about Gojek? How many of you know about GoPay? Okay, good, fine. So let's talk about what does Gojek do, right? So Gojek is a super app. So what does that actually mean? It comprises of what would normally take several apps to do, but it does it in one single app. So Gojek is an open service provider in Indonesia and other regions in Southeast Asia as well. What do we do? We provide variety of different urban services, you name it, right? So you want to move from A to B, you want to get a taxi, we provide that. We provide ride hailing in both 2- and 4-wheelers. You want to get food delivered from your favorite restaurant to your house, to your office, we do that. You want to book tickets for a movie, we do that. You want to get medicines delivered at your place, we do that. You want to send packages from one part of town to the other, we do that. You want to go to a grocery store and pay, we do that too, and which is what we will talk about today. Gojek was established in 2010. So initially, our CEO, Nadeem Makarem, he kind of ran the whole thing on phone. He kind of ran a call center and picked it up from there. We started out with ride-hailing services, particularly on 2-wheelers. So the name Gojek, the words O-J-E-K over here basically mean 2-wheeler riding services in the Indonesian language. So which is where the company name comes from. So and from there, from ride hailing, we figured that, hey, we have riders at our, meaning who are working with us. So they could not only transport people, they could also transport food, they could transport your Amazon packages, for example, if you want, they could transport a variety of different things. And from there, the ecosystem grew into what it is today. So we are the first and the only unicorn in Southeast Asia. So we launched our first app in 2015 on the Google Play Store and the iOS Store, and from there we've seen rapid growth in terms of the amount of users that we see and also the kinds of services that we do. Coming towards the title of today's talk, right? So what does GoPay do? So what's the whole pay business over here? GoPay is the payments arm of Gojek. So by payments we mean the entire digital transaction space. So we provide mobile wallets. We provide online transaction gateways. You say you were to log into Amazon and try to place an order, the payment transaction gateway is we provide that service. You walk into your favorite Kirana store and you want to swipe your favorite debit card or credit card, we provide those machines as well. So when you walk into a store, typically over here as well, you would see they would have an array of different machines based on what bank you come from, right? So we cut that clutter up and say, hey, have one machine, no matter what the customer shows up with, you can guarantee business. So the merchant is absolved of the headache of saying, hey, I can only accept these cards. You're like, hey, you focus on your business, leave the payments to us. So we help the merchants on that front. And we also provide point of sale systems in the sense, the whole inventory management and billing. So we provide those as well. So that to the merchant, they focus on what they do and the entire billing plus accounting system, etc. We kind of take that brand and say, hey, you focus on what you do best. We accepted across several merchants, websites, you name it, and we recently got accepted on Google Play Store. So if you go to Indonesia and you want to buy a game or any of these other things on Google Play Store, we are an accepted method of payment, which is one of the first in that entire region for non-established players. So what's our agenda today going to be like, right? So the first and foremost is we are here to talk about understanding user churn in GoPay. So we first want to define what is churn, what does churn mean for GoPay, particularly given our business model. How do we mathematically define it? How do we translate this business problem of churn to a mathematical problem that we can actually model? How did we go about building the model? How did we evaluate whether our model was good? How did we run different experiments? How did we prove that what we were doing was actually good? And what scope do we have to improve? And last but not least, we will talk about how our software infrastructure works. how do we go from somebody hacking around in say Jupyter Lab to actually stuff running in production, right? So how, that entire spectrum is what we will talk about. So yeah, so Sruthi, who's our data scientist at GoPay, will talk about what does churn mean, like how do we define churn, etc., and take you through that journey.
So churn and GoPay. What is actually customer churn? Customer churn is a problem which is there across all industries, all apps and all platforms. So what does it mean? It means that how you are identifying which are the customers who are leaving your platform or app, and you have to, what do you do with them? You have to win them back. There is no point in making a business or running a company where your customers are not happy, engaged and loyal to your company. There is no point acquiring a lot of people if you can't retain your old customers. And so how do you define churn? Assume you are a company which works on subscription platform. When do you know that your customers are moving out? So on a subscription plan, if a customer stops the subscription or cancels the subscription, you do clearly know that he is moving out of your service. But how does Gojek or GoPay work? Gojek or GoPay does not work on subscription-based plan. So we have to redefine the entire customer churn to customers who have been inactive in the platform for a specific period of time. How do we come to this specific period of time? And why was it hard for us to define churn for GoPay? So as I already told you, GoPay is not a subscription-based plan. Second is GoPay is a payment gateway in Gojek, and Gojek as a platform, it serves like multiple different services. You have 20 different services in GoPay, Gojek, and apart from all of this, GoPay can also be used offline, online, and for peer-to-peer transactions. Each of the service which GoPay serves has works on different natural frequencies. Say for example, I'm a customer A who is taking a GoRide, which is a ride-hailing service of Gojek, every day to commute to office. And I'm a customer B who is using Gojek only for paying his bills. The frequency at which the customer A functions is 1 or 2 days. And if he does not transact for at a minimum of 4 to 5 days also, we can say that he is about to churn. It is different to a customer B who is using this app only once in a month. So when I want to build a model which is agnostic of all the services and which with a specific period of time, which is common for all the customers, it was difficult for us. How did we approach this mathematically? Let me give you a broader view of what was the problem statement we were trying to solve. So we were trying to identify users who will not transact in next X days. And the task was to define this X, which is the churn cutoff. Okay, intuitively, you can say that for every customer, this period of inactivity is always a function of his past intervals. Let's take an example of a user, say Ms. X. She signed up the app on say day one, and after 30 days, she made her first booking. Then after 10 days, she has made her second booking. Then she forgets about the app, and one day she wants to use it again, and then she booked her third booking after 50 days of period. I'm standing today on August 1st and I look back at this customer. So I can see that her maximum booking interval has been 30, 10 and 50. Maximum of it is 50. And her recency of the last booking, which is defined as the interval between last booking from the cutoff, which is today, is 90 days. And also the overall maximum period is 50 and 90. Maximum of it is 90 days. How do I say if this customer is more likely to come back or more likely to churn? I can see that she has been inactive for 90 days, but she has never been this silent in her past at all. So I can say that she is more unlikely to come back. Assume the reverse case. Say I'm looking at another customer whose recency is 50 days and he has been inactive for a longer time than this. So I can expect him to always come back. This is the variable lead transaction. So if this lead transaction is false, this customer is more unlikely to come back. And if it is true, she can always come back. I can assume that she'll come back. Based on this, I bucket all my users in the platform to two buckets, a blue bucket and red bucket. Blue bucket are the customers who can return, and red bucket are the customers who do not return. After doing that drill for all the customers, we make a bin frequency plot. So what is this bin frequency plot? It is for all the days, maximum interval days overall. I try to plot the count of both the buckets. The blue line shows the number of people who are belonging to the blue bucket, and the red line shows the number of people who are belonging to the red bucket for every maximum overall days. So here you can see an interesting point where the blue line crosses the red line. What does this mean? Beyond this, you have a region where the number of people who are not returning becomes greater than the number of people who are returning. You can understand it like this. So say, assume as I go on towards the right on this x-axis, the number of days become like 150 days, 200 days. So if a person has been inactive for 200 days, after 200 days, if a person is coming back, the number count is always lesser than the people who do not come back. So this churn, this point is called as the hard cutoff. To the left of this line, you can see an interesting plot of this distribution of this blue line, where it keeps increasing first and then it falls. What is this point where it attained a peak? So in the early regions, the maximum days will be like 20 days, 30 days. So from 0 to 30 days, the number of people coming back will always be more. It keeps increasing. After say around like 30 or 40 days, the people who are coming back will be greater, but the slope of the line falls down. Here the slope is positive and here the slope is negative, and the lines are approaching, which means this is a vulnerable region. And this we call as a soft churn region, where even though your probability of return is greater than the probability of not return, since the lines are approaching each other, this is a vulnerable region. Let me explain you this graph much better in another version. So what is this graph? This is the same graph, but I'm just showing you the return population versus churn population for every maximum days overall. This is the same hard churn point which I showed you, where your return population was equal to your churn population. The ratio is 1. And this is the point where your soft churn point, where your blue line peaked, where your ratio will be back maximum. So where do I keep my churn cutoff, which I will be using for my model? I can keep it either at hard churn point or soft churn point. There are pros and cons of both. What will happen if I keep in hard churn point? So beyond the hard churn point, you do know that all your customers have already left your platform. So winning back a customer who has already left your platform is very hard, and you have to incentivize him more to bring them back, which is not a good model. So you have to target a customer when he is starting to lose interest on your business than to target him after he has left. What is the problem if I keep it equal to the soft churn point? Can you go back? If I keep it equal to the soft churn point, I will be including all the customers to the right of this point, which will include a lot of customers who are naturally returning. If I'm keeping it at equal to soft churn point, my model will tell all these people are also churning, and I will be targeting with them with lot of incentives. Although they naturally return, I'm wasting a lot of money on them, which is not a good model. So I should keep my threshold somewhere in between soft churn point and hard churn point. So for our model, we kept it somewhere in between, which was a function of all the natural frequencies of the services which our customers were using. Okay, prediction model. So as I was saying, now that we define the X, which is the churn cutoff, this problem actually becomes complete. And when you read this, you can solve this using a simple classification technique. So how did we make our train and test data sets? Assume I stand today, August 1st, and I want to know, given assume my churn cutoff, which I got out of that stats is 1 month. And I stand today on August 1st and I want to predict how many customers will churn in the next month. The prediction population that I'll be taking is the past month, and I just slide this entire window 1 month back, and I make my train population train labels and use this model to predict for this window. So coming up to features, what all we used for this model, it includes like demographic. So demographic is like customers who have KYC'd or not KYC'd, what were their service areas, where do they operate. RFM of transactions will be recency, frequency and monetary of all the cancelled and completed transactions within GoPay. Then wallet balance and top-ups include the liquidity of their wallet, the how many top-ups they do, RFM of top-ups, peer-to-peer transactions, etc. Then voucher usage, how active are they on the platform? Even if I target them with an incentive, will they redeem it or not? User feedback and app experience. So user feedback is every customer after booking, making a booking, he'll give a feedback, submit the feedback to Gojek platform. And app experience is all their click-through rates. So again, after collecting the data, doing the same drill of checking correlation, collinearity, we started off building a logistic regression model. That is where we know how is our data, like we understood the features better, and we did a lot of feature engineering post this based on the results coefficients and p-values we got after the logistic regression. Post this, we iterated a lot on the feature set and the model, and we built up XGBoost model which went on to production. So coming up to metrics, how did we treat our metrics? So you should always have a trade-off. You can't have your precision and recall high in all your models. So you have to understand your business case and treat which one is the best. So since the output of this model was going for a targeted intervention, so what is the output of this model? It will be a list of customers whom we are predicting to churn the next month. I give this list to a team which will run experiments and target these people. So here, the cost of running one extra incentive is very less compared to cost of incurred when a customer leaves. So we, in our model, we always treated recall more important than the precision. So the experiment design and software infrastructure will be dealt by Karthik.
So far, so Sruthi talked about like how, what exactly do we measure and how do we like measure them, right? So do we care about recall? Do we care about precision? So now we will get to like, how do we do this in terms of an experiment? Like, so I've built the model, I can't affect the entire population that like I go affect, right? When Gojek has 16 million users, I can't like take everybody and throw the feature at them. Then that's not going to be good. Like, so you, we have to do this in a controlled way and run a statistically significant experiment, right? So that I can get real results out of it. So that's what we will focus about now. The first thing to note when you're doing churn modeling is the moment you give people an incentive, you can no longer predict which way they will go. So the model is trying to figure who is going to churn. The model is not trying to predict what they will do if given an incentive, right? So the moment you give them an incentive, you have changed the state of the system. So the way to truly measure the performance of a churn model is to not do anything, right? You know these people are going to churn, but you have to sit back and wait. Hey, let's see which of these people are actually going to churn. Well, that sounds great in theory, but we still want to win back our customers, right? So we will get to incentives in a bit. So in case you are to do absolutely nothing and just observe what did people do, right? So you are going to have some population who actually, whom we predicted will churn, some population who actually ended up churning. We would all like the case where this overlap is very big and not as indicated. So ideally, this intersection is going to be really large. So now it basically becomes like a standard classification problem where you can figure out precision and recall. Like you have a real label, like you have a predicted label and you have a real label, right? So that way, understanding the efficacy of the model directly is fairly straightforward. But now let's get to like, okay, great. So I know if I sit back and look at what happens to these populations if I do nothing, I understand how well my model is doing, but I'm not winning back customers, which implies business is losing. So what happens if I throw an incentive into the picture, right? So if I throw an incentive into the picture, so I'm going to give So I have some predicted churn population. So I believe, say, some 100 users are going to churn, right? Now, I don't want to give all of them a particular incentive. So say I'm going to select 20 people over there and say, hey, here, take this voucher that's going to give you, I don't know, like 70% off of your transaction value, right? So I'm going to throw this, give this voucher to them and observe how do they perform. And I'm going to take an equivalent sized population. So if I take 20 people here, I'm going to take another 20 people here and say, hey, I'm going to target this population. I believe that these people are going to churn, but it do not give them an incentive. So this way, I can actually do two things. One, I can measure the efficacy of my incentive. So here, when you compare the experiment and the control, you know how well your incentive has performed. So how well did my 70% off voucher do? Like, how many people took it? And how many people actually, like, if people take it, then they have then fundamentally they have been retained in the system, because the moment they do a transaction, then they are active in your platform. Using the control, that's also going to have an intersection between the predicted population and the actual churn population. And hence, using the control, you can again reformulate it like the previous slide and do a precision recall. So that way, you measure both your model efficacy as well as the efficacy of your incentive. So now, let's look at, okay, great. Like, so far we've talked about the math and the setup. Like, so how does this, like, what is the tech part of this whole story, right? Ultimately, like, we need code to run in production. So how does this work? How have we thought about orchestrating this, and how have we orchestrated it? We are largely on the GCP stack within GoPay Data Science. Our primary orchestrator in this entire setup is Apache Airflow. So Airflow provides an interesting way to, I think there was also a talk yesterday about Airflow over here in the PyData conference. So Airflow provides a really neat way for you to schedule complex tasks that have multiple steps in them and also schedule them at certain frequencies. So that becomes our primary orchestrator. So our data largely lives in Google BigQuery. And given our use cases are very batch oriented, like every month after month or every after a few days, we want to figure out, okay, hey, whom should I go provide incentives to? So that's a very batchish use case. So and like hence we need like a big data store, and Google BigQuery serves that very well. GitLab is our version control system. So all of our code lives in GitLab and gets pushed around into Google Kubernetes Engine or Airflow or Airflow server. Airflow is, at least the interface to Airflow is through Python. Our model itself, the XGBoost that Sruthi was talking about, was written in R. Let's take an example of how does this work, right? So we have a scientist, in fact, Sruthi was the one who wrote the model. So she writes to GitLab like, hey, I'm writing what my DAG is going to be like. So a DAG is a directed acyclic graph that basically says, these are the various steps I need to do. A step could basically mean, like, I have to query the data, I have to transform it in a certain way, and then finally, like, you know, call a Python function and do something with it, or like call an R script and provide it this data. So that lives in GitLab. And all the training scripts that come with it. Here I've written train.py, but it's actually written in R. The train data SQL is basically what is the data that you actually have to procure for building the model. So that we have a SQL script, and Airflow has a BigQuery operator where you provide it a given SQL and say output this data into a particular BigQuery table, it will do that for you. So we basically push this into our like a hosted Airflow server, and that basically triggers a run of this particular DAG at a certain frequency. So the first thing it's going to do is query data, which will basically take this SQL, like send it to Google BigQuery and like fetch back the results, right? And like store it into a table. After that, so this train.py that you see actually gets containerized, because we can't expect, so this is going to be fairly memory intensive, right? Because building that model is going to take, say, in our case, we observed about like 40-50 GB of memory. So like we can't expect this one machine which is running Airflow to do this whole thing, right? So hence what we do is we move the code off to a Google Kubernetes Engine instance. So we containerize all of our scripts, and that gets done by GitLab itself. So it, when you trigger a GitLab build, it goes to Google Container Registry. So the Docker image that you build, and the Airflow instance basically pulls this image, sends it to a Google Kubernetes Engine cluster that we built, and runs the code. At the end of the code, basically the list of people whom we believe are going to churn goes to Google BigQuery, and like the model, like the like a pickle file of the model or a feather file of the model gets stored into Google Cloud Storage. So in one shot, basically, like Airflow deals with the entire end-to-end process, thanks to, of course, Google Container Registry and Kubernetes Engine as well, that the scientist just needs to check in code into GitLab, specify a particular schedule, and yeah, Airflow takes care of the rest. Key takeaways, brief glimpse through everything. So we want to define churn. What happens when you define churn in a non-subscription based model? You wait for inactivity. That becomes your definition of churn. You want to compute the appropriate inactivity period, like how do you actually define that period? And we saw Shruti walked us through that graph where you saw the two curves kind of diverge. Building the predictive model, how do you train and how do you test? Where do you derive features from? What period do you train on? What period do you test on? Experiment design, like if you want to purely measure model performance, do not touch the user. Just let them be, let them churn if they are going to churn. And you also calculate incentive performance. Last but not least, like how does software deployment work? A variety of different tools. Airflow is basically the key deal over here. And Kubernetes engine so that your compute stays away from Airflow itself. I think with that, we'll take a pause. If there are any questions, happy to take them.